Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. Kim has just left so we can ask Joyce about the pail. God damn it, I just bought that net. Kim was really interfering, did not want us to hear about the pail, afraid that it would affect our psyche. Will it, though? Let's see.
You're back. Good. What can I help you with?
She takes a sip from her silvery thermal cup. Questions about reality? Is that it? Think of something close to you. Skill points into esprit de corps, okay. Now that we're alone, what is pale? Are you sure you're sure? Your colleague seemed adamant. Yes. What is the pale? Okay, she concedes. The pale is the most dominant geological feature of the world, detective. The separative tissue between the isolas. It is the intersolary mass. Wait, and what is an isola? Isola is a Messian word... Messinian word, actually, I think, for a continent of matter enveloped on all sides by the pale. Also, isolation, or landmass. We used to believe there was only one. In the last 4 centuries, we have discovered 7. Mundi, Sol, Samara, Ilmara, Grad, Katla, and this Insulind. And Insulind is... an oceanic isola. It comprises mostly of water. Mundi is the largest, Katla the coldest, Insulind the bluest. What can I say? She stops. Each is perishing and dear. Mundi is like the word for, like, world. I think it's in Latin? A Latin word? Okay, what is pale like? Achromatic, odorless, featureless. The pale is the enemy of matter and life. It is not like any other, or anything in the world. It is the transition state of being into nothingness. Logic says the negation of being. The negation of... That's right. The negation of being. She tightens her hood around her neck. It's cold outside. Is it here? No, detective. We're safe. She points to the sea. It begins there, 6,000 kilometers to the north, and even more to the south, east, and west. You are in the middle of the isola. Inland Empire says, as your gaze instinctively turns north, a small black pit opens up in your stomach. 6,000 kilometers from the end of the world? Yes, that is enough. Many cities are built much closer. And, pointing north, there? An uproar of matter, darling, rising into the pale, rolling, evaporating even. A great vision. The area of transition between the world and the pale is called the porch collapse. Imagine a gray coronal mist, cold vapor, marked by spores of an opportunistic microorganism, a mold that's adapted to grow at the edge of the unrest. It's... She closes her eyes and breathes out heavily. The most disco thing you will ever see. Huh? I wonder if it has anything to do with what was going to come down on that church. That was the most hardcore thing we've ever heard. What are its physical qualities? It's difficult to describe, or even measure, something whose fundamental property is the suspension of properties. Physical, epistemological, linguistic. The further into pale you travel, the steeper the degree of suspension, right down to the mathematical. Numbers stop working. No one has yet passed the number barrier. It may be impossible. Rhetoric says, there's a slippery article in there. Is it the pale or pale? Pale when it's particular, this territory of pale. The pale when it's pale and it's entirely. Once you've seen it, she tosses her head. Language balks at the difference. How much pale is there compared to the world? The pale outweighs reality, 2 to 1. There's more pale than there is matter, and the ratio is slipping. Slipping how? To our detriment, or... What do you think, detective? She looks you in the eye. It's growing. There is more and more of the pale. Precisely. One of the few measurable effects of the pale is that it is expanding at an unknown rate. An intuitive conclusion of that development is that one day the pale will cover everything, but this sort of talk is mostly left to extremists. Cover everything? That can't be. Where would we go? Most people, and indeed most private and government sector organizations, entire civilizations, and religions even, find handy ways to ignore or downplay that knowledge. I suggest you do the same. Inland Empire says, off we go. You see the hanged man's mouth open. Off into the wild pale yonder. One and all, she closes her eyes. They say pale is death, but for the universe. Inland Empire says, why should we just leave, and the world get left behind? If we're surrounded by pale, how do you get from Isola to Isola? Oh, it is... Her lungs deflate. Her words sound like a sigh. So difficult for us. It is possible to force dimensions on the pale. In modern times, we can even compress its latitude, bouncing radio waves from one end to the other, shortening the path. But it's still hard for humans to navigate the pale without getting lost or having our minds damaged. The pale can damage the mind? Maybe we've been there. Maybe that's why we can't remember things. Extensively. How? Some say the damage stems from extreme sensory deprivation. Others that pale somehow consists of past information that's degrading. That it's rarefied past, not rarefied matter. They call it the blend over of the self. The pale does not only suspend the laws of physics, but also the laws of psychology, maybe history even. The human mind becomes over-radiated by past. Redrick says, who says and who argues? Okay, who says and who argues? The logical positivists say, the dialectical materialists argue. What does this over-radiation feel like? It feels terrible. Absolutely terrible. International standards strictly limit civilian travelers to 6 days of pale exposure per year. Logic says it's more for her. Way more. You're not a civilian passenger? No, Lieutenant Dubois. I'm intraplanetary business class. I'm cleared and trained for 22 days of pale transit annually. Empathy says, perhaps that explains her strange pining after the revolution. Some degraded early memories? Logic says, someone else you've met may have been exposed as well. The strange gray-haired woman in her lorry. Oh, right, her name's Pale Driver. Do lorry drivers pass the pale? Yes, carried in the holes of airships, she nods. It's a horrific job. Automation will abolish it soon. Reaction Speed says, you should ask the pale driver about this. See what she says. I will. Inland Empire says, that poor woman must have stories to tell like you wouldn't imagine. I think that's what it is to talk to her. Because we had something we had to do, but it was very low because we had -10 for not knowing about the pale. So I think it was her. Are you over-radiated? Up to my gills, officer. Endurance says, acidic smile on her lips. It's getting worse every year. What is entroponetic? Entroponetics, she corrects, is the scientific study of the pale, or a recent iteration of it, by way of Grodd. The study of the pale reaches back 6,000 years. The Paracanassians called it the Western Plain. Rhetoric says they had not traveled the entire circumference of the Paracanassian Superisola. It was not merely in the west, it was everywhere, even then, surrounding them. Did they cross it? The Western Plain? There are signs of preter-modern crossings. Successful navigation of the pale relies not just on technical know-how, but intensive psychological preparation. Some of these tactics must have been known for thousands of years. What has entroponetics changed, then? Nothing. We remain powerless before the pale. The only real advance in pale transit is the speed with which an aerostatic craft can pierce it. Less exposure leads to less effects later. Aerostatic craft? Hybrid airships, Detective. Conventional rotors or jet engines no longer add velocity after the point of reference for motion is suspended. Once you've crossed from near pale to far pale, in essence, we throw them in and they come out the other end, if we throw them precisely. If we do not, then they don't. Visual calculus says, gone, like a skipping stone beneath the surface. Let's return to reality, please. Yes, sweet reality. She stomps her foot. But before we do, tell me, detective. Is this the first time you hear this? Do you really not remember anything? I'm getting a sense of who I am, but no, I didn't know this. Beyond curious, tell me, what do you think of the pale? Do you mean disco? Mean like disco is dead, that the pale is death? It will end all life, it's terrifying, yes, yes. To that and that. You continue to persist of all as a testimony. Not too. It's advanced, can only stop with immediate... That's not gonna do anything, I don't think. It doesn't care about politics, I don't think. A communist... no? Doesn't sound liberal, no. I don't know how we survive with it. It's terrifying. Her eyes tense. Crow's feet radiate from them. She observes you, your bloodshot eyes and swollen face. Endurance says, your ailing constitution, sweaty forehead, the beads there, and your heavy breathing. You really didn't know. This does not spell good for the investigation, detective. If you don't know even this, then... She stops mid-sentence. I'll handle it. It's under control. I hope so. I truly do. If I may suggest, hold on to your colleague, Katsuragi. I ran a check on him, and he is very competent. In the meanwhile... Empathy says, some of that assurance is meant for herself as much as it's meant for you. She must have a lot on the line here. Yeah, I picked that up from her. Well, complete. You have me. I will assist you in any way I can, even if we have to do it one basic term at a time. She gives you a slight bow. I can't do that. See if there's anything else I can check. I'll handle it. I'm not going to change anything. Well, look at that. That's all I have to do. We can pick up our dice now. Thanks, Joyce.
Aye, the sea's gonna calm down soon. I can feel it. The wind is turning southeast. What's on your mind, officer?
Nothing yet. I need to put more into suggestion. I need to suggest things to her. Successfully. I'm headed back to the old lady, actually. Well, let's get our dice on the way. I'm glad we have our gun back. I'm having trouble negotiating. Is that a... That's funny. It's not actually a task. But I won't forget. Oh, we can go in this way. Oh, wait, no. That's not it. This is it. there's more light up here than upstairs, I guess. Or down here rather than upstairs. Let's see if I can negotiate it without the... Well, apparently I can't even move without the flashlight, okay. This thing never goes out on me, yeah. I mean, I know the way, he just can't negotiate it without the light. He won't let me do it. Alright, give me some dice! Oh, it's you again. Are you looking for a die? I came back to pick up my die. Very good. That will be 7 real for 1 custom die. Here you go. Standard anti-wirral die. 1 universal die for Wirral Untethered. The dice maker opens her desk drawer and hands you a die. Look at it. It feels icy. Just holding this die in your hand sends a jolt of cold down your spine. Through the dark resin, you can make out a nugget of bone hewn from an alligator's jaw. I can't... That's the die I had already. It's a standard anti-wirral die. This standard 24-sided role-playing die can be used to get results for several dice. It's made of alligator jawbone, cast in acrylic resin, and embellished with frost motifs. Looks like a minuscule blizzard is stuck in there. Note, look at the map tab in journal to see which white checks have opened. Ooh. Don't mind if I do. I don't see anything new, though. And these people are not around anymore. Kim was already unchecked. Class J, smoke around the balcony. This is all the same stuff. Suna the programmer. Logic. Okay. Suna might be new. I can't order anymore. I can't even buy anymore. Alright. Well. Thanks! Let's go talk to what's her name. Pale Rider. I didn't even make the connection between Pale Rider and Pale. I mean, maybe I did, I just forgot about it. But I didn't realize anyone went into the Pale. Figured it was an impenetrable thing. It was doom. All right. Look at that. We're not doing this. Yeah, we got past Measure Head another way. I don't want to become a racist. I mean, maybe that's not what ends up happening. Just learn about it, and then we can decide we don't like that. I don't know, but either way, I'm not going for it. We need to find a firearm that shoots this kind of ammo. Don't know where. Actually, we were supposed to talk to what's-his-name, Titus. But let's go talk to her first. Titus might know something about this firearm. And or ammo. I'm gonna write this down. Talk to Titus. I don't want to forget. This stuff isn't appearing in our journal. Quest logs. Lillian for the date and Titus to talk about all this crap going on. Alright. Pale Rider. But she remembers the past. But apparently the Pale comes from the past or something? Or brings up the past in you?
Loman, you caught me at an opportune moment. This awful weather keeps me awake. You can entertain me with your questions.
I think I know what's going on with you. And what is that? She sticks a filterless cigarette into a cigarette holder and reaches for the light. You're a Pale driver. You transport goods through the Pale. Oh, me do. The lawman solved the case. She lights the cigarette. A white cloud of smoke disappears into her mouth. And here I was thinking you were an idiot. She breathes out, and the air tastes sweet. So, are you? An idiot, I mean? Does she transport drugs? Is that where all this is coming from? I blacked out from sheer heartbreak and lost all memory of the world. Like Gabriel Bringuero in Segura Mi Preso, she nods and smiles, unkindly. You're the opposite of me, then. I remember everything, even the things I never knew. I thought it causes a memory loss. Things you never knew. The small liquor on Gabriel's lips after the shoot, in the motor park, the roses on the day of Franco Negro's coronation, on the grand stairs of rail, the smoke from the fouling piece when Dolores Day was shot. The look on her face, like an orgasm, the wound in her chest, my hand in my father's hand. She closes her eyes, her eyelids trembling, except I never had a father, and I never shot her innocence, Dolores Day. Over-radiation? Heroic doses, Zarif. Heroic. Isn't that dangerous? Thought insertion? Dithering? The grad Katla Magistral? She savors the lungful. It's more than dangerous. It's sad. But at first I had to make a living. Now, when you've seen it all go away like that, rolling off like the sea, and then come back to this. She gestures at the square, the broken horse monument, the clanging of machines in the distance. What we are doing here, for thousands of years, Gabriel, it doesn't have to be like this. We can just give up. We can just become vapor. What does it look like, the Pale? Like looking into the ocean at night, in the dark. And you cannot see it, but you know it's there, and it's big, bigger than anything, bigger than all the other things combined. How does it feel like? Nothing, until it starts. When you're deep enough, then for me, it's like autumn. Dark gray and orange, the orange of streetlights and the color of trees and the electric light. It smells like autumn, too. It smells terrible. Empathy says nostalgia. Cooped up in the cabin, shaking. Terrible nostalgia. For yourself, for humans. It's too much to bear. She loves it. How do you pass through it? In the belly of an airship, behind steel windows, so you don't look straight into it. It's not advised to look into it. Not on this lorry, then? No, the same one. A roller. They are all are nowadays. Special wheels for connecting to the floor of the hold. She points to the machines, clumped up like toys. Interfacing says they're wheels, all small and round. Multi-axle trailers. One last thing. You said we can just become vapor? Yes. Rhetoric says, no elaboration. I would rather have what I have than what you have. I would rather have what you have than... Wait. I would rather have what you have than what I have. Or actually, I feel I already have what you have, in some way. They say there is a point, one that I have not crossed, in the Pale Superdeep. If you stray too far off course, on the U-41A, or in Lomonosov's land, where every step you take is one step further from home, no matter the direction. It's a point you cannot come back from. Your mind becomes so radiant with the past. There's a flip. She flicks the ash from her cigarette. Instead of writing, it erases memory. nearing some kind of... She shakes her head. Indescribable finale. Maybe you've been down the motorway south? She looks at her cigarette. It's almost out. She has swallowed it hungrily. Then at you. The motorway south? It's a story us long-haulsmen tell. Long-haulsmen, Zarif, not pale drivers. Way beyond the established pale that's lit by radio frequencies. Where it goes silent. And dark. And the process begins. Erasure. Kilometer by kilometer, in any direction. The motorway south is a road you cannot come back from. Conceptualization says, in the center of this town is a ghostly motorway. She sang. It takes all the people where they want to stay. They say I've been away on a kind of holiday, she replies silently. What is at the end of the motorway south? No one knows what's at the end. She takes a cigarette out of the cigarette holder and extinguishes it. I've only glimpsed the beginning. Thought gained from motorway south. I've only felt it in a distance when I was a child. She goes silent, her eyes close and her hands shake. A child rowing on the lake. Ma'am? Hoisiana. A sigh escapes her lips, then silence, as she stares within herself. Empathy says there is nothing more to do now. She's far away. Conceptualization says she is receding in the clutches of some indescribable scattered emotion. A child descending. So, motorway south. At the edge of the map, the land mass begins to disintegrate into pure trigonometry. The ocean melts, becoming a tangle of sines and cosines. The mountain range turns into a sharp-angled azimuth. The green range shadow dithers, like music turning into a waveform, and then vanishes. This is the end, a half-remembered textbook from your childhood. The porch collapsing on the edge of the isola, a transition from reality to pale. A single vector shoots out, like a rocket. It's the motorway south, splintering off from the known pale. To where? Where's it go? Temporary is minus one visual calculus for bizarre angles. Takes 8 hours, 10 minutes to learn. I do want to learn it. It was one of these two we forgot. This I like. Gives us money. All endurance, white checks unlocked, learning cap. Let's forget this one. Let's think about motorway south. Take us quite a bit to do that. That'll take place tomorrow at some point. So she will not answer now. The woman looks at nothing, her eyes closed and her lips moving. Right. What's this? I didn't notice that before. We got speed bottles. I didn't see that before. So now we have more of these things. 9 uses. 3 each per bottle. Oh, that's the Ruby's cab. You've already checked that out. Let's see if we can go catch up. We can get over there with Titus. Not here, it's too late. I can try with this guy again to learn his, what do you call it? What about his composure or something? What is it about the way he carries himself? Fail. Yeah, nothing. Okay. Well, they've left these people. The horse-faced woman and my old partner.
Hey, was there something you needed?
No. Nothing at all. Should we hang out and play a game? I don't know what else to do right now. We need to wait, come back in the morning to talk to Titus about stuff. Maybe he knows about the working firearm. The only other person I could think... There's a blip there for a second. Might be the pawn shop guy. Pawn shop guy. Ammo. I'm writing notes to myself. Okay. I do want to buy the other, the Warval game. Oh, it's Interact, right? Board game for Suzerainty. A civilization building board game where you get to choose a nation and sort of to colonialize and exploit other cultures. A star-shaped note on the box proclaims the game now includes a completely new genocide option. Let me just put the flashlight away. Where was it? Here. In your hands, you hold a brand new copy of the game Suzerainty. It's snugly wrapped in a skin of plastic. The cover features a charming illustration depicting a mass of grinning laborers loading goods onto a ship while a richly dressed administrator oversees their work. Encyclopedia says, the exact location and time period are left deliberately vague, but it's clearly meant to represent the economic relationship between the Revacholian Suzerainty and its many vassals. Shake the box. The box has a nice heft to it. You hear the rattle of individual wooden tokens and feel their weight shifting back and forth. Inland Empire says, what treasures wait in store for you? Even before you open it, you can tell this will be a meaty game of grand strategy and complex player interactions. Remove the plastic wrap. The plastic wrap rips off as easily as a bodice in a tawdry historical romance. Alright, opening. There's a hiss as the lid slides off. Inside, you find a thick, full-color rulebook and more than a dozen pouches of various wooden components. Read the rulebook. Welcome to Suzerainty, a game of economic strategy for the whole family. The whole family, which features genocide. The rulebook is sumptuously illustrated and thick as a Gradian novel. The instructions are opaque at first and introduce many concepts you're not familiar with. Fortunately, there are many diagrams and examples throughout. You soon figure out the basic conceit. Each player represents an administrator for the suzerain of Revachol. Your objective is to increase the suzerain's wealth and renown by accumulating victory points. How do you accumulate victory points? That's where the suzerain's vassals come in. The game features four vassal nations, each one home to an economically important resource. Each turn, the player collects resources from vassals where they've placed workers. They may then rearrange their workers, fulfill contracts for coin and bonuses, or build structures back in Revachol. Reaction Speed says, as you leaf through the pages, your eye catches on a sidebar labeled Advice for Beginners. Read the advice. Remember, there are many paths to victory in Suzerainty, but successful players will find one strategy and commit to it wholeheartedly. How is the winner determined? The actual scoring system appears infinitely complex, with a series of tables and appendices required to compute each player's victory point total. You skip that part for now. Examine the components. You open up a number of pouches containing wooden tokens. There are also several punch boards with other cardboard components that will need to be punched out before you play. And I'm going to buy a note for myself to buy Wirral, because these are things not on the list. So my personal little quest log written down is try to go on a date with Lillian, talk to Titus once it's morning, ask pawn shop guy about the ammo, and buy Wirral. Punch out the cardboard pieces one by one. Each cardboard token makes a satisfying chick as you pop it out. Soon, a neat pile of cardboard coins and counters has accumulated before you. Ooh, I like that. A good, orderly task that leaves you feeling relaxed and accomplished, interfacing says. Check out the wooden tokens. In addition to the worker and building tokens used by each player, there are also several piles of colorful resource tokens, each representing one of the game's four principal resources. From the Empire of Safre, orange apricot tokens from Ilmarat, the ancestral name of Ilmara. Gray marble block tokens from the Seminine Islands, white sacks of sugar tokens, and from Supermundi and Semeritzia, magenta tokens for unprocessed cocaine leaves. Put the components away. It's a shame there's no one for you to play with. You hold the open game box before you. Put the game away. Alright, play Suzerainty with Kim. All right. Oh, there's something else. There's one more thing. I know we're getting along, but there's one more thing to look at. The other book about... what's his name? The man from Hjelmdall. We bought the other one, didn't we? Or did we not? Maybe not. Oh, here it is. Hjelmdallermann. The man from Hjelmdall. I'll just read this and then we'll call it an episode, so it's probably going to be a longer one. But what the hell, I want to finish this stuff off. And then we'll go back and go to sleep. Probably next episode, yeah, we'll start with sleep. A classic. On the frontispiece, an anatomically unrealistic muscle man is reaching into a mountain stream, yearning to touch his glimmering mirror image. His eyes are full of childlike wonder. On the blood-soaked snow right next to him lie two giant Zweihanders. Zweihanders? The cover of this tattered paperback features the man from Hjelmdall standing atop a pile of bloody corpses. His two Zweihanders are crossed over his massive chest in a dramatic X, their blades dripping with gore. Seems over the top. Behind him rise the harsh, snow-capped peaks of his native Northlands. In bold red letters, the title Hjelmdallermann, the man from Hjelmdall, unfurls like a banner. In the foreground, a nearly nude woman lies spread in supplication, her privates strategically covered by her flowing black hair. Naked women and giant swords, conceptualization says. Is that really the best they could come up with? Feels formulaic and derivative. I'm pretty sure I haven't read this one. I know I read the other one, the devil woman or whatever. Look at the back cover. The back blurb reads, his latest adventure serves as the perfect introduction to the savage Hjelmdall saga. Meet man from Hjelmdall, his faithful blood brother Tyrbald, the noble Lord Hrothgar, and some of their most fearsome foes yet for the Northlands, for Hjelmdall. Perception sight says below, in smaller font, you see the parenthetical adapted from man from Hjelmdall and a necromancer's treasure, man from Hjelmdall, Lord of Hrothgar, and man from Hjelmdall, the curse of Nectherer? Logic says, a brazen attempt to bilk fans for more money by splicing together old stories under a new title. The publishers must have a dim view of their readership. Their main concern is the continuation of the franchise, not making literary history. Read the first couple of pages. The story opens in media res. The man from Hjelmdall and his band of northern reavers are in the bowels of an ancient temple, surrounded by an army of gibbering wights led by the deathless necromancer. One by one, the brave northmen fall to the relentless crush of undead, only to join their number as reanimated corpses. By nightfall, only the man from Hjelmdall and his blood brother, noble Tyrbald, are left standing against the dead horde. "It is an honor to die by your side, brother," Tyrbald cries as his battle axe beheads one of their reanimated comrades. Wow. They're in trouble now. Probably not. "Nine, Tyrbald," the man from Hjelmdall bellows over the army of flesh and bone. "Have courage, for the Northlands, for Hjelmdall." For himself? Okay. He leaps to the mezzanine to face... Oh, he's the man from Hjelmdall. So he's... Okay. So have courage for Hjelmdall, as in the country or region or whatever that Hjelmdall is. Not the man himself. He leaps to the mezzanine to face the black-eyed figure and like a mad ice bear, what is that ice bear again, whirling twin Zweihanders, Sturm and Drang. Sturm Brightblade? Dragonlance? He plows through the ranks of the deathless surrounding the necromancer. Head-eye coordination says, the rider has never held a sword in their life, let alone two-handed swords at the same time. Logic says, it is physically impossible for a human being to effectively dual-wield Zweihander swords in any kind of real-life combat situation. And with deadly finesse, his twin blades scissor the necromancer's head from its body. The undead legions collapse like rag dolls as the dark magic leaves them, and the two Northmen stand alone in the accursed temple where the bodies of their lost brothers litter the floors. Skip ahead. A few chapters later, the man from Hjelmdall and Tyrbald are in a completely different setting. High above an arid desert, riding a pair of griffins that always seem to appear at narratively convenient moments. Conceptualization says, this book makes a mockery of the very idea of good plotting, though something tells you coherence was never the point. The Northmen find themselves in the court of a powerful southern king, Lord Hrothgar. The old king beseeches the man from Hjelmdall to rid his kingdom of the Necktherer, a subterranean clan of blind wizards who traded their souls for demonic powers. The man from Hjelmdall extracts a high price from the desperate king. He asks land for the homeless desert pygmies living exiled in the kingdom's borderlands. Hrothgar offers the hand of his eldest daughter instead, but the son of winter does not budge. Hold on, why is the man from Hjelmdall doing any of this? What do you mean? Why is he doing any of this? Because the flame of justice burns bright within his chest. Because above all, he's striven to bring honor to the land, to the name of his beloved Hjelmdall. Because his noble Catlin bloodlusts for glory and conquest. It cannot be denied. Is that all? What do you mean, is that all? Is there anything else to his character? He's the man from Hjelmdall, forged in the fury of battle. Death was his sire, and blood his dam. He had but 14 winters when he left his frigid homelands in Katla to seek glory and honor. That is his character. Conceptualization says, he doesn't even have a real name. What is inside this man? Or is muscle and bone all he is? Physical instrument says, hey, nothing wrong with muscle and bone. Conceptualization says, the point is, why should you care about this character? Does he have any inner conflicts? Unspoken motivations? A tragic flaw, perhaps? Exactly. Where's the tension inside him? There is none, I guess. He is the wildest man alive, the only mortal strong enough to wield the twin Zweihanders, Sturm and Drang, whose names mean storm and... Yes, I get that. He's strong and has big swords, but why should I care about his character? What are you, a book critic? I'm arguing with a book. I might be. Enough! You're ruining the pacing of the story. I think the pacing is already... a shambles already. Now, where did you leave off? Ah, yes. Conceptualization says, what pacing? You skip past the section detailing an elaborate banquet with many toasts, as well as the long and perilous journey from Hrothgar's keep to the ancient forest of Yezdor, where our heroes infiltrate the Necktherer's dire hall. In the center of the great hall stands a blood altar, on which a pair of Nakthera are disemboweling a shrieking peasant, an unholy rite that empowers the Naktheras of forbidden magic. As the vile ceremony ends, the sound of steel unsheathing draws the Naktheras' attention to a pair of cloaked figures standing in the doorway. Swiftly, the visitors toss off their cloaks and unsheathe glimmering southern steel. It's the man from Hjelmdall and his valiant blood brother Tearbald. Well, yeah, who else would it be? In an instant, the Naktera summons a horde of gibbering orcanoids. Orcanoids who rush our heroes. The hall fills with the clang of blades and the screams of the dying on the floor as the floor goes slick with the steaming orcanoid viscera. Conceptualization says, oh, for bleep's sake. When the dim of battle settles, only the man from Hjelmdall and Tearbald remain standing. Exhausted and dripping with the entrails of their foes, the two Northmen confront the foul Naktera. The man from Hjelmdall's soda-light blue eyes fill with indescribable fury. For the Northlands, he cries, rushing headlong into a desperate melee. You gotta be kidding me. What? This is almost exactly the same as the first scene. Even the word gibbering is used twice. Oh, was it? In the first scene, the man from Hjelmdall fought a powerful necromancer and his army of undead, or of the dead. Now he's confronting a pair of Naktera and their horde of orcanoid thralls. The two couldn't be further apart. Okay, fine. What happens next? An excellent question. One easily answered by purchasing the next thrilling chapter in the Hjelmdallermann saga, Hjelmdallermann at the Gates of Tomorrow. The last page of this book really merely reads, to be continued. Logic says, considering the sheer amount of different Hjelmdallermann books out there, it's very unlikely you're ever going to find the sequel. The man from Hjelmdall stares at you on the cover, his face fixed in grim resolve. Okay. I read it. It's late. Now we've read all the books for the library, unless they get more. And, this is all we have to do. I don't know where she is. I don't know where that is. And I guess talk to Titus about that. Maybe. He might know. Something's done. I don't know what it is. But my personal journal is to ask Liliana to date. Talk to Titus in the morning. Ask the pawn shop guy about ammo. Buy the Wirral game. And maybe play it with Kim. And maybe play Suzerainty with Kim, if we can. If he's willing to. It would pass time, but... I don't want to pass too much time, but we don't have much to do we? I'll think about it. In any case, there's at least a few of these things that we have to do. That's not on the journal. So thanks for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, and always seek adventure.